Your Majesty, Your Highness, Your Excellencies, co-host of the conference, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. The tragedy striking the people of Syria, who sought refuge away from the carnage in their country, has dramatically afflicted other people in other countries. Poverty, misery, disease have swelled and indiscriminately plagued the Lebanese and the 1.5 million Syrians that now constitute almost a third of the local population, grafted as they are on a limited pool of national resources and services that were largely insufficient for Lebanon's own inhabitants. Recognizing that there is categorically nothing acceptable other than temporary presence, and despite the difficulties they face, both the government and the people of Lebanon have interacted with the Syrians in ways that go far beyond what is required by international conventions, human rights, and moral principles. This has not gone without a price. Unemployment and poverty increased considerably. Growth fell to zero, and shortages became more critical in everything, from space in schools and hospitals to water and energy supply, all at a prohibitive cost to Lebanon's economy and to its environment. It took time for global awareness to recognize the protracted nature of this crisis and to admit that the answer lies in long-term support. It took time to recognize that limited humanitarian assistance alone is not the key. It took also time to understand that development aid alone addresses the problem at its root. Only economic opportunities and jobs improve livelihoods, preserve dignity, and gradually render benevolency unnecessary. This conference should be the opportunity to recognize that the true solution is a political agreement in Syria, a road fraught with uncertainties. And we saw what happened yesterday in Geneva. That the only answer to the refugees' ordeal lies in their return to a normal life in their country. That there is a real risk in seeing migratory streams continue to flow beyond neighborhood countries, and that we should beware of transforming despondent communities into a fertile ground for extremism. Let all this inspire this conference to introduce the much-needed changes in the approach of aid, but also make improvements to its mechanisms for ensuring that contributions are effectively paid, thus vitalizing the present system of pledges. Specifically, what is called for, ladies and gentlemen, is a contract. A contract, a bonding element that translates promises into moral engagement and moral engagement into tangible support, effective help, and concrete outcomes. By this I mean projects, programs, jobs, income, kids in school, enough food, vaccination campaigns, roofs in the rain, warmth in the cold, a smile on every child's face. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, these are the new indicators that we would like your engagement on our side to be measured by. Lebanon is not able, nor should it be expected, to finance this global public good. Annual humanitarian appeals are underfunded, kids are not in school, and food rations are smaller every day. Soon, Lebanon will no longer be able to contain an eruption that could involve further migration to distant shores, destabilization, and evolved security threats. This conference should represent a shift in the international response to the crisis. Time is running out. The statement Lebanon presents today affirms that the success of the conference will depend on the implementation of a set of mutual commitments between international partners and the Lebanese government. We should all rise to the challenge and remain above inconsequential considerations. It may be that modest budget extensions could help preserve social equilibria in the world and safeguard social values for centuries. Let us carefully weigh the trade-offs. This is not a time for smart negotiations. This is a time for empathy. This is a time for intelligent understanding. This is a time for vision. Most of all, this is a time for courage. Thank you.